When's the next mission to Saturn going to be, and what would you want to find out based on this mission that you don't already
know? Don't know when the next mission is going to be. There are some studies being done in the States at the moment. And depending on which scientist you talk to, some would like to focus on Titan and Enceladus. I'd like to focus on Saturn, but I'm still not quite sure what we would want to do. We need to get the best out of our data. You know, one of the things about data sets is they're a treasure trove of information. And I think we're pushing the data as hard as we can at the moment, but there will be scientists that come and look at it in the future and find new and interesting things. So I'm partial to Saturn at the moment, but that's just because the end of mission has been so spectacular.
But presumably it's only every so often that the sort of other planets are aligned, so you can sort of do this sort of slingshot out to...
You can do really quick slingshots. The Voyager spacecraft were really NASA was really fortunate because all the planets were lined up beautifully. So it took Voyager spacecraft rather a short amount of time. But you can always get out there. It's just whether you want to take 5 years or 10 years to get out there.
Okay. Questions, comments, please wave wildly because I've got some very bright lights shining in my eyes.
I was wondering, the visible surface features of Saturn, I think that there's a different rotation at the equator than at the pole because it's a gas.
Yes.
And I would assume that in the metallic hydrogen interior, which is liquid, right? Because that's how the dynamo works.
Yep.
That would also be rotating differently, and that's what's producing the magnetic fields.
Yes.
And all of these things are moving at different speeds. So I guess, to what extent can we say that Saturn has one single day when the period of the equator, the pole, the interior, and the rock are all different?
Usually when you talk about the rotation rate of a planet, you're talking about the interior rotation rate. Mm. But yes, there are. There are lots of different rotation rates in the atmosphere, and Jupiter's the same. You've got different rotation rates in different parts of the atmosphere.
Can we infer the rocky rotation, which isn't part of the dynamo
Can
we infer the rotation of the rocky bit, which is not part of the dynamo, from the liquid part, which is?
I think you're pushing it a little.
Okay.
You can use models and simulations to try and do that, but you can never be sure.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
Thank you for a wonderful talk. That
thank
was
you.
Splendid. Can I ask a sort of romantic question about Enceladus?
Okay.
you showed us a slide that said simple organics and complex organics. What does that mean? Is that life, or is that amino acids, or what?
It's before amino acids. So you would need something else to happen to start the life process. And that's where the length of period of time comes in. Having ingredients is not enough. You need the process to be stable enough over time that something can happen.
Yes, thanks for a great talk. The other open question as well as the rotation rate was the age of the rings. And can you say something as to what you currently know about being able to age the rings and knowing whether they're something very recent or something that's formed over a great deal of time? And what physical principles do you use to determine that?
Oh, now you're really pushing my knowledge. I think the only thing I remember about, part of the F-ring, part of the ring grazing orbits, that the science driving that was to try and get an understanding of the composition of the rings, using gravity to also try and get an understanding of the age. And my recollection is they're younger than people think. What that means, I don't know. But if you go to the Cassini JPL website, I'm sure that there's a write-up about that. It's not my field at all, so I don't know the details of it, I'm afraid. But my understanding is they're younger than ring scientists thought they were going to be, but not recent.
Okay, someone in the gallery. Is there a microphone up there?
Shout out.
Yeah, shout out, yes.
Could you tell me, please, what you were saying, the possibilities of life on Enceladus? Do you think that is the most likely one? How do you rate that?
To I knew I was going to get one of those. It's very difficult to tell. I would be very surprised if there wasn't bacterial life of some kind somewhere. I think the outer moons in the solar system are a good possibility because we know, for example, in some of the deep regions in our Earth's oceans, you can have bacteria forming in conditions where you really think it's simply not possible. I think for me the real step change that's happened in the last 50 years or so, which has really been underpinned by the Cassini observations of Enceladus and the desire and the new missions that are going to Jupiter's moons, is the fact that you can have liquid water at quite big distances from the parent star. People have always thought that you can only get liquid water on the surfaces of bodies. And so that, you know, if you're looking at exoplanets, you need to look at planets that are close to the parent star. But we've seen with the Jupiter moons, so Ganymede, Europa, and Callisto, we think they all have liquid water under the surfaces. And we've seen with Enceladus as well that you've got liquid water. You don't have to be close to the parent star. So I think for me, that's been the real sea change. And I didn't answer your question, but that's as far as I'm going to go.
Okay, somebody else in the gallery, could you shout, please?
Enceladus is tidally locked. Can you say whether the tiger stripes point towards Saturn or an angle to?
They're at an angle to the north pole of Enceladus, so I think they're at an angle to Saturn. But that's just based on looking at the images. But yes, they... Sorry, do you mean the side that's facing Saturn or the side that's facing away from Saturn? Is that what you meant?
Apologies if my question wasn't very good, but yep. Basically, if you're Saturn,
yes.
And I'm Enceladus,
yes.
And this is the South Pole,
yep.
Are the tiger stripes pointing towards you or at a transverse angle?
It's at a transverse angle. Yep.
Over there, please. Just wait for the microphone.
First of all, thank you for a great talk.
Thank you.
Also, I was wondering, for the tiger stripes, do you have any idea where they came from? Like, were they asteroids colliding in or something like that?
Don't think so. I think it was something happening in the interior. So there was a huge amount of pressure building, and they had, and the liquid water and the water vapor that was being generated needed to escape.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah.
We think something similar happens at Europa, one of Jupiter's moons, but there, it's almost, you know, when you see images of Europa, it's almost like, you know, when you fly over Greenland, I don't know if you've ever flown to the States, and you fly over Greenland, you look out of the plane, and you see the bits of ice breaking off from the edge of the ice shelf. That's what it looks like on Europa. It's different at Enceladus, but we think it was driven from internal processes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Someone again in the gallery?
You know how you showed the image of Enceladus, the expected heat map,
yes.
And the actual heat map?
Yeah.
Where does it get all the extra heat from?
That's the million-dollar question. It depends which scientist you talk to. Everyone has their different ideas. The easiest solution is that If a moon orbits around a planet, if the orbit is completely circular, then the moon will feel the same gravitational pull all the way around. But if the orbit is not quite circular, so in some parts of the orbit it's closer to the planet than in other parts, the gravitational force is strongest. And so that pulls the interior out of shape. And so it keeps it warm. It stops it from cooling down. And so the easiest solution is to have the heat source being the orbit around Saturn. That's the easiest way. There are lots of other ways as well, but...
Please, give away the microphone.
You mentioned how fantastic it was to work with such an international team.
Mm-hmm.
Could you tell us more about the design process? How did you coordinate the design of the spacecraft? In the very beginning of the...
I wasn't involved right in the beginning. I became involved after the instrument was designed and it had just been delivered. But the way it's working on the Jupiter mission, where I am involved in the design, and it will be very similar, is that you write a proposal to build an instrument. Well, first of all, a space agency decides to select a mission to go somewhere. And they then put out a call for instrument ideas, and you write a proposal and you describe the instrument that you would build and the science that you would do. And you try and get the best team around you so they've got no choice but to choose you. And you then submit the proposal and you go through a selection process, and a selection team will choose the different instruments. And then you get together and you talk to the space agencies and you say, this is what I want to do. And they say, okay, we've got 12 instruments. Where are we going to put them? We can't get instruments getting in each other's way. How heavy can they be? How much data do they need? And that's the process that we're in at the moment for the Jupiter mission. And for me, it's really interesting because it's completely different to planning the science, which we will do once the instrument's been built. Yes. What we did is we knew on Cassini that the 11-meter boom that we had was perfect because we didn't see changes taking place on the spacecraft. I hope no one from the European Space Agency is here. But when we first started designing the Jupiter instrument, we said to the space agency that we really wanted a long boom. And they said, no, you only need a 5-meter boom. And so what we did is we said to them that the size of the field due to the spacecraft that we can be allowed to see at the end of the boom was so small that the only way they could do that was give us a 10.6 meter boom. But don't tell them I said that.
Clearly Enceladus is losing a reasonable amount of mass, so the whole phenomenon must be transient.
Yes.
Do you have any idea about what sort of magnitude of time the phenomenon could last for?
No, we're almost certain it was taking place in the early, maybe the mid-1800s, because there were observations made from the Earth of something strange when you looked at Saturn. And they didn't know what it was, and it took a very long time to work out that there was an E-ring in the first place. So it's been happening for a long time. Not long in the lifetime of the solar system, but it can't go on forever. But I'm not going to put an answer to that. I'm not going to give you a number for that either, because I don't know it.
Okay, one last... Please, over there, Martin.
You mentioned that the initial plan was, I think, once you arrived at Saturn, to hang around for 4 years, but clearly managed a lot longer.
Yes.
So it would seem that somebody put more fuel in the spaceship than was initially required.
You always do.
So to what extent do you build flexibility into the design and the mission, and how politically difficult is it to get an in-flight change?
I'll answer the first question first. You always put lots of flexibility in. You always over-design because it's not as if something goes wrong, you can't go and tweak something. So you need really robust instruments, for example. And one of the things that surprises people is that the type of instruments we fly, they almost look quite old compared to some of the new gadgets that we have. But the reason that you do that is to be able to fly an instrument on a spacecraft mission, you need to show they're at a technology readiness level of 9, so they need to have flown before. So you can't fly a mobile phone to take pictures because it hasn't shown that it can work before. So you always over-design, you always have redundancy. For us, we had 2 instruments. And on each of those instruments, you had extra power supplies and extra bits so that if something went wrong, you could move to another bit. But there's always extra fuel. But you also learn how to use that fuel as well. You get to know how the instruments and the spacecraft work. But it went on a lot longer than anyone thought, certainly. And then the political question, I've forgotten what it was. Oh, you've got to persuade the funding agencies to fund you. Because, to be able to operate the spacecraft and the instruments and do do something useful with the data, you need to pay people to do that. And so the way that we did it on Cassini is a year and a half before the nominal end of mission, we put a proposal into NASA to say we wanted more funding. And so you need to almost make a new science case every time.
Okay, so with that, I think I will draw things to a conclusion, and just remains for me to thank Michele for sending us a super postcard from Saturn. So thank you so much. Thank you.